Hi everyone, I'm Panda Global Sakamaru Red, and I could not be more excited to tell you about a new Shadowverse card. First and foremost, I'd like to say this video is sponsored by Cygames, and I want to personally thank them for giving me the opportunity to reveal this card to you. Without further ado, let me walk you through a bit of history on Shadowverse and give you a bit of context on how you can use this card in an effective manner. When Shadowverse was released on Steam, there were two main sets, Standard and Darkness Evolved. On that meta, there were two powerful amulets that were shaping it, Path to Purgatory and Yelena's Prayer. Path to Purgatory was a 4 play point neutral amulet, mainly played by Forestcraft, that whenever the requirements were met, was capable of destroying your opponent's board and their health. On the other hand, Yelena's Prayer was a 3 play point Havencraft amulet that whenever your leader was healed, would create powerful boards or this big follower that was hard to remove. In the meta, there were cards that were capable of dealing with those amulets, for instance, Execution, a 5 play point neutral spell, or Petrification, a 3 play point runecraft. They would either destroy the amulets, banish them, or transform them, and essentially remove them from the board. We would have to wait almost a year and a half to see another amulet rise in popularity and be played at a high level. That would be Tilting at Windmills. After the Bahamut nerfs, this Dragoncraft amulet for 7 play points would be a big investment for the big payoff of having your neutral cards in the game quite quickly. Later that year, two more amulets would take the stand. Support Cannon, a 5 play point Swordcraft amulet that was incredible in the Dawnbreak Night Edge meta, as well as Tinko's Shrine, a 5 play point Havencraft amulet that was a big powerhouse to the Brigade of the Sky meta. Notice a trend here? All the cards we mentioned before are a big investment on your play points for essentially no impact to turn your development, only to get and recover that investment later on the game with incremental value. During this period, four more answers to those types of cards surged. Burly Axe Wielder, Suttungur, Seraphic Blade, and Fall from Grace, as well as Vols to an extent. Unfortunately, all these cards were more expensive in terms of play points than their targets, were not very flexible, or would give more value to your opponent than yourself. With this in mind, I'd like to introduce to you Battlefield Inquisitor. Battlefield Inquisitor is a 9 play point 5-5 silver Havencraft follower that evolves into a 7-7. You can pay 5 play points for its accelerated effect and destroy an enemy follower or amulet, similar to Execution, or you can pay 9 play points for its 5-5 body with Fanfare, destroy an enemy follower or amulet. So, in rotation, this card can actually be more viable than the previous ancestor we already had, both because of its accelerate mechanic being flexible, it's cheaper in cost, it has a more relevant body being a 5-5 that can actually win the game, it can swing tempo in your favor on turn 9, a point in the game where evos are not very, are non-existent actually, or it can actually deal with both a follower or an amulet. In the limited, with the amount of powerful cards we have in the format, I doubt Battlefield Inquisitor will be a relevant card. However, in Take 2 is where it actually shines. This card is insane on it, I believe. Both because it is a flexible card, it's where you want to be, has the accelerate effect, you can pay 5 play points for a hard removal, which is something important in Take 2 as well. You can swing tempo in your favor at a point in the game where there are not a lot of evolve points, as well as being able to win the game in a couple of swings. It dodges a lot of the removal spells, it forces your opponent to spend a lot of resources to deal with it, and trades are not very favorable. It's capable of killing most of the followers that exist. In rotation in particular, you have to be careful because it struggles with wide boards, it struggles against very fast strategies, and it struggles against the destruction theme for Portalcraft as they are immune to destruction. In the future, we'll have to see what this card holds. If strong amulets or strong followers are printed, this card gets a bit more relevant. But what I really want to talk about now is the art. When I saw it, I fell in love with it. This card feels both powerful, both divine, and godlike. It is well worth to note that the character with the horned helmets is reaching out to Battlefield Inquisitor, and it shows me both despair or hope that he arrived. This ambiguity in the character really makes it sound like a godlike character or a divine presence. It is a good and perfect portrayal of what a Battlefield Inquisitor should be. He arrives on a battlefield, asks you questions, and you better have the answers. I also like the fact that he fits the theme of Havencraft very well. There are a lot of cards like Priest of the Cudgel, Judge of Retribution, Father Punishment, All the Sister, and All the Priest cards. They are both fitting a religious theme, as well as the Divine Retribution and the Justice one. Battlefield Inquisitor is the guy you want to have. I can't wait to see his voice line, or rather listen to his voice line, and see what his flavor text has to say. And there you have it. That was Battlefield Inquisitor, a new addition to Shadowverse. Hope you guys enjoyed this reveal as much as I did. You can play Shadowverse today by downloading it on Steam or your App Store. I want to see you on the battlefield competing. May your answers please the Battlefield Inquisitor. I was Panda Global's Akamaru Red, and bang bang.